To have scientific racism, you need the concept of race. Even if we dismiss everything I've said so far on this issue, race must be shown to be a real and meaningful biological concept. My main critique of Stodel's in this regard is that he simply omits the wealth of counterarguments that abound. He acts like race is a meaningful, useful term in science, and it's not. I'm not trying to pretend that there's no controversy here. However, according to an article by Lisa Gannett in the British Journal of the Philosophy of Science, a consensus view appears to prevail among academics from diverse disciplines that biological races do not exist, at least in humans, and that race concepts and race objects are socially constructed. So let's begin our story with a pop quiz on genetic science. Dr. Sylvia Spangler, a geneticist at UC Berkeley, is told, "We have a group of four men. If you are able to look at just their genetic code, their DNA, which of these men have the most genetic differences?" Her response, "I have no question, given what we know about genetics, human genetics, that the tall person and the short person are significantly more different than the black man and the white man of similar height. In fact, geneticists calculate that all humans on the planet share 99.9% of their DNA. In fact, chimpanzees have a wider degree of variation within their much smaller population than we do. Moreover, it's pretty well established fact that human variation is greater within groups than between groups. According to Brian Sykes, the Oxford geneticist and author of The Seven Daughters of Eve, I'm always asked, is there a Greek DNA or an Italian gene? But of course there isn't. We're very closely related. In biological classification, there are two and only two relatively unambiguous categories. These are the species and the individual. Both are virtually closed units. The individual is a single organism. The species is the unit which can breed with itself, but not with another like unit, and so breeding produces fertile offspring. A third unit, the breeding population, is less definite than either the individual organism or the species, because gene flow among such units can occur. Breeding populations are subunits of species in which, for various reasons, such as geographic isolation, or in the case of humans, marriage rules that forbid mating with certain categories of individuals, almost all of mating takes place. To give you an idea of just how ambiguous race really is, we need to look at it in its historical context. The original English usage was more akin to species, which we now know is false. In an article written for a popular journal in 1891, Henry Cabot Lodge quantified the distribution of ability by race in U.S. history, counting biographical encyclopedia entries. Counting biographical encyclopedia entries as proof of ability, Lodge tallied 10,376 excellent Americans from the English race, as against 1,439 of the Scotch-Irish race. The English race furnished 1,482 times as much excellence as the Italian race and 3,458 times as much as the Greek race. One able poll graced Lodge's charts. So notice that just over 100 years ago, I would have been considered biracial, half Irish, half Italian. My families became white in this country, and this subject is explored wonderfully in Working Towards Whiteness, How America's Immigrants Became White by David Roediger. In fact, in Sinclair Lewis's novel Babbitt, we see a racial commentary of white riders on a train approaching Pittsburgh. At one point, a man in a velour hat begins thanking God for immigration restrictions, especially on Italians and Slavs. "These daggos and honkies," he said, "would have to learn that this is a white man's country and they ain't wanted here." Or consider the wonderful attributes extended to my Italian ancestors by the prejudiced wasp, Henry James. "The Italians, who over the land strike us, I am afraid, as after the Negro and the Chinaman, the human value most easily produced." Or consider the other half of my ancestry, the Irish. Irish and African Americans had lots in common and lots of contact during this period. They lived side by side, they shared workspaces. In the early years of immigration, the poor Irish and blacks were thrown together, very much part of the same class competing for the same jobs. In the census of 1850, the term mulatto appears for the first time due primarily to intermarriage between Irish and African Americans. The Irish were often referred to as Negroes turned inside out, and Negroes as smoked Irish. A famous quip of the time attributed to a black man went something like this: My master is a great tyrant. He treats me like a common Irishman. Free blacks and Irish were viewed by the nativists as related, somehow similar, performing the same task in society. It was felt that if an amalgamation between the races were to happen, it would happen between Irish and blacks. But ultimately, the Irish made the decision to embrace whiteness, thus becoming part of the system which dominated the oppressed blacks. Although it contradicted their experience back home, it meant freedom here, since blackness meant slavery. So I think I've established that just over a century ago, I wouldn't have been perceived as white. The ephemeral nature of the term race can also be seen in the numerous ways people have tried to define it. In 1888, according to experts, there were between 2 and 63 races. In 1924, various scientific authorities put the number of races between 4 and 29. William P. Dillingham began a massive study in 1911, which counted 36 races indigenous to Europe among 45 races entering the United States. In the 1950s, biologists and anthropologists began to think seriously about the problems caused by the static nature of their classification systems for humans. It was the field of chemical genetics, particularly the study of blood groups and their world distributions, that had opened it to the field of study. The best-known work of this type was done by the biologist W.C. Boyd. His 1950 book on blood group distributions brought about a revolution in thinking about human variation. With the proliferation of field studies of genetics among populations, it soon became apparent that race was a flawed concept. Few, if any, populations in the world had exclusive possession of even single alleles. Instead, populations could best be distinguished one from another in terms of varying gene frequency. That is to say, most alleles were found to be quantitatively distributed across the entire species, with some groups having higher or lower frequencies than others. Instead of neat biological units, or races, each one separate and distinct, the biologist was left with a set of overlapping distributions with different means and a good deal of overlap at the edges. To grasp the nature of human variance, I'd ask you to visit a very interesting website, understandingrace.org. They have a wonderful graphic there that depicts human variation among the various populations. There's a large blue circle that represents all of us of African descent. That's all of us. Every single human is of African descent. The differences, very small by any quantifiable measure, come about depending when our ancestors left Africa. Not very long ago by evolutionary standards, maybe 50,000 years ago, it shows two smaller circles inside the African circle, and they basically overlap. Check it out. You can see what I'm talking about. Suffice to say that there are scientists who hold contrarian views regarding race. However, what I've hoped to do is show that this is not the consensus view among scientists, and you'll find a great many links in the sidebar that I hope you will take the time to explore.
Oh yeah.
I see no changes. All I see is racist faces. Misplaced hate makes disgrace to races. We under. I wonder what it takes to make this one better place. Let's erase the wasted. Take the evil out the people, they'll be acting right. Cause both black and white and smoke a crack tonight. And the only time we chill is when we kill each other. It takes skill to be real, time to heal each other. And although it seems heaven sent, we ain't ready to see a black president. It ain't a secret, don't conceal the fact. The penitentiary's packed and it's filled with blacks. But some things will never change. Try to show another way, but you're staying in the dope game. Now tell me what's a mother to do. Being real don't appeal to the brother in you. You gotta operate the easy way. But you made it in a sleazy way. Sell a crack to the kid. Well, hey, well, that's the way it is.
Yeah, well,
that's just the way it is.
It's just the way, it's just the way.
Things will never be the same.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta make a change. It's time for us as a people to start making some changes. Let's change the way we eat, let's change the way we live, and let's change the way we treat each other. You see, the old way wasn't working, so it's on us to do what we gotta do to survive. And still I see no changes. Can a brother get a little peace? It's war on the streets and a war in the Middle East. Instead of war on poverty, they got a war on drugs so the police can bother me. And I ain't never did a crime I ain't have to do. But now I'm back with the facts, giving it back to you. Don't let them jack you up, back you up, crack you up, and pimp smack you up. You gotta learn to hold your own. They get jealous when they see you with your mobile phone.